So I just got myself a new vintage computer, and I'm ready to clean it up and plug it in and have it all set up, load down with the software and all that. But this particular computer is not ready, and you might have the exact same problem that I'm running into right now. And it's here on the monitor itself. You see, I'm looking at it right now, and it looks like there's some sort of dust that's currently on the screen itself, or something's not right, like the middle of it's clean, but the sides are not. And I can try and rub it off all I want with a rag, and it's not going to come off at all. And that's kind of concerning to me. Maybe I've broken the CRT. Maybe the front of the CRT is broken. This is not any of that. The CRT itself is actually fine. What we're looking at here is a case of something that's called cataracts. So what exactly causes cataracts? Well, as I've already told you before, it's the strange speckling effect that's occurred around the outside edge of the CRT face, and here in the middle, it's still completely clear. But so what exactly is it? Well, the front of the CRT isn't actually the front of the CRT. There is an additional safety measure that's involved here, which is basically an extra piece of glass that acts as a guard. In the event the tube implodes, you're not gonna have glass flying out of the front of the computer case. It's gonna try and hold it inside of the monitor itself. To hold it there, there is a clear material, which is basically polyvinyl acetate. And what happens is that after several decades of existing simply, the outside edge here is more susceptible to being exposed to open air as opposed to the middle. So you begin getting this speckling effect as the PVA material begins to decay. And eventually it will get so bad where this spreads all the way to the middle. If you have an HB terminal or an LSI ADM3A terminal, this is a very common thing for you to see. And again, for you TV folk, color TV sets will come around with this as well. And by the late 80s, the 90s, and pretty much now, they've switched the material they've used as a bonding agent. So you don't see this as much anymore. But it can get so bad that it'll start to actually decay inside of it. And that's what you can see right over here in this this glitteriness. There's actually gaps that have formed inside of the PVA material as it has chemically broken down. And this becomes a more liquid or fluid material, which will drip down. And I wouldn't say it's acidic, but it is slightly corrosive. And it will damage integrated circuits and printed circuit boards should it drip onto it. So I strongly suggest that if this is starting to happen, you gotta replace it. Now there are a variety of ways that you can go out and remove the protective cover and therefore the cataracts on the display like this. And well, one of them is the hot wire. We can use a hot nichrome wire on that. We can leave it in a bathtub and it'll soak, and the PVA material will eventually detach from the screen, and that's a pretty easy way. But I like to use a technique which is very commonly used already on much larger CRT television sets, and that is to use a heat gun and a very hot lamp to separate the safety glass from the PVA material itself and then scrape it away. There's also a couple of things you're going to require in order to make this work at all. First thing is that you're going to need a heat gun. You're also going to need a high-powered light. I'm using a 500-watt halogen lamp that I have currently hanging from my workshop ceiling. You also will need a couple of rags. You will need some sort of way to monitor your temperature. I have a cheap infrared point-and-shoot thermometer right here. We'll need a roll of clear packing tape. We'll need double-sided foam pads. We will also require a package of razor blades. You will also need a very sturdy workspace to do this all on. You will also need a metal bucket. The reason I need a metal bucket is because the high temperatures of the tube, I do not want melting the plastic bucket itself. A metal bucket will work just as well. However, you need to insulate the sides. When you place the tube on, make sure you use your rags to support the tube on either side. We don't want the cold bucket being right next to the extremely hot tube. There is a very high variation in temperatures and bad things can happen. That's another thing I want to get involved with right now. There is a disclaimer on this. While you are dealing with glass and this is a fairly straightforward job, there's always the risk that the tube could implode. Do not expose the tube to extreme temperatures. For example, once you have the safety glass off and you scraped off the PVA material, don't douse it in a cleaning fluid that's cold or anything like that. We don't want to stress the tube. Remember, while it is glass, it's under an extreme vacuum. Now, before we can do any of that, of course, we have to pull the entire display apart. Your mileage will vary exactly on how you have to pull your display apart, but in my case here, it wasn't too difficult to do. Give it a try in yours, and then come back to this video. There. So we now have the monitor disassembled, the deflection yoke has been taken off the tube, and we now have the tube sitting inside this bucket here with the padding on the side. Now before we continue on with the cataract removal, or preheating actually, we need to remove the tape which lines around the tube itself. That is where our blades come in handy, and it's as simple as one small swipe. Now before I take the tape off as well, I also want to point out that there is this metal band which goes all the way around the CRT. And in this case here, we do actually have these mounting holes which it was attached to the monitor with. On some sets and some CRTs, this is a removable band. On this one here, however, it's currently folded over itself and crimped. We don't want to remove this. One, because it's a complete pain to reattach it. Two, because, well, we have no way to recrimp it. And three, on this particular tube here, this is one of the internal measures that's used to prevent the tube from imploding. Once you take this band off, there is a much higher risk that the tube itself will implode almost spontaneously. I couldn't even be in the room and it'll just go off, maybe. But thermal stresses like this, very bad. So we're going to keep the band on for this. But the tape I'm talking about is this black material here. And it may be clear on some sets. And all I want to do is just cut it. And in this case here, it's just going to break apart. But I'm going to cut it very carefully along the edge here. I don't want to try and score the tube, otherwise that compromises the glass. And we're just going to go around the tube and remove this tape. I also seem to have a kind of a fiber tape on here as well. I don't want to remove that as it goes underneath the band. And presumably that's just, again, part of the implosion prevention, or just to make sure the band doesn't nick or damage the tube. And it's a real mess on here. Like, I can scrape off some of the PVA material. This is all completely perished. And we do seem to also have some cellophane tape under here as well. But I just want to get this black tape off here. So we've basically separated everything except the PVA from the safety glass, so it comes off easier later on. Oh, and I got this side here. That looks like it's all of it. I'm just going to give one last quick pass here to ensure that that's okay. What on earth is this? Okay, that's just more PVA material. And you can just see how it just kind of slices off. In some cases, what you'd also use is chopsticks or something like that to poke underneath in the heat of the sun and pry it off. But we're going to use the heat gun method again on this case here. All right. So that looks like that's everything on this tube here done. And now that we have the tube itself prepared, we can now begin the preheating. Now the preheating is essential when you're using the heat gun, because with the heat gun, we're gonna be causing certain spots of the tube to get a little bit hotter than the rest. And again, that stress on the glass, I don't wanna have onto this tube. With the preheat there, not only are we gonna be evenly heating the surface here of the tube, but the entire glass envelope of itself, which is insulated from the bucket, is going to heat up as well. So I'm not going to have any heavy stresses once I begin the heat gun. Now, there are a number of ways you can do this. A number of people put black plastic bags over this and leave it in the sun. Other people will leave them in their cars in a hot day, but some people here don't live in the most hottest of environments. So I'm using the halogen lamp, which I mentioned earlier. And all I'm doing is I have about, 6 or so inches of space here. And now all I have to do is turn on the lamp. And I'm going to come back to this every, 20 minutes. I'm just going to check on the temperature. And after about an hour, we should be in the range of about 220 to 300 degrees Fahrenheit, which is the optimal temperature for removing the safety glass. So I'm going to go for a little bit of a break here and I'll come back. And we are back, and we have now reached about 160, 170 degrees on the outside edge. And near the middle, we're sitting at about 240 degrees. We are right in that magical spot there, about 10 degrees below, but that's not a problem in this case here. Because, as you can see, we already have some bubbling, which is going on right here. And that's what we want to do with the heat gun, but the lamp preheating has already managed to loosen up a little bit. So I'm just going to go and I'm going to raise the halogen lamp here and we'll get to work on the heat gunning. There we go. Now, remember the tube is now very hot and once we're done here, we're going to have to lift off this piece of safety glass. So I have a rag standing by on a table here. And now we are going to begin the heat gun. What I want to do is I just want to start out in a corner. And what I'm looking for is you're going to see a little bit like little fingers, little air gaps that are going to form inside of the PVA material. And that's basically it detaching from the glass. It's already starting right here. And I can just see it kind of edging its way over. Now in the meantime, I'm going to go across here, and I can already see it acting over here as well. And I'm trying to make that going all the way around the tube so that all these little bubbles meet up in the middle. At which point, I should be able to lift completely off the top of the tube the safety glass with absolutely no effort. There, one just formed right there. So there's another gap. I can probably make this one here bigger as well. So see if I can bridge it onto that. And I can see it right here as well, the fingers that have formed. You can see one that's currently racing away towards the middle there. That's exactly what I want to see. The PVA material is lifting, or it is softening, and now it's formed a giant bubble on top. So I want to spread all of that out so I can reach everywhere and basically pop the glass off. Now one thing is that you got to go back over areas once you've finished with them, because as it cools, it will re-adhere back to the glass. So I haven't done this corner here for a bit. I'm already starting to see it lift over here, so those should start forming together pretty soon. There it goes again right there. I can touch the glass now and I can actually see it react, so we're getting pretty close. I'm going to go back over to this corner here, see if I can get those ones to go together. There we go, I'm starting to see it bubble up. I don't want to stay focused on one spot for too long. Aside from the thermal stresses I'm putting on the CRT itself, it's also the sheet of safety glass. If I were to break that, I'll be completely out to lunch. And I'll explain why we need to keep the safety glass a little bit later on. I'm also seeing a lot of bubbling going on actively inside here. That indicates to me that the PVA material, at least in this formula, is very soft. This tube is being a little bit more stubborn than the last ones I've worked with. Usually by now I have some more fingers up along the edge, but it looks like because it's so liquid, all the gas that's usually used to force the cavities to be bigger is escaping. I might have to end up just to heat it up to a point where it's soft enough, I can just kind of pry it off. Okay, I think it's pretty certain by now at this point here that we're not going to be able to get any more bubbles to form in here. Because right now we're cranking up to a good couple hundred degrees and we're still not getting any more bubbling. I can't even spread out the one here in the middle. So that's a pretty good indication that we're pretty hot. So I'm going to try and go with our razor blade and just see if I can kind of prop up underneath. I don't want to apply too much force as it will cause the glass to break. I mean, once this softens up, it just slides right in. There we go. That's what I want to see. And it's just pouring those giant bubbles there. Perfect. That's what I wanted. I'm just going to pull that out. Gonna go over here. I'm also using scored razor blades. The idea is that if I put too much pressure on the blade, instead of the glass shattering on me, the blade will snap. See if I can get that to bubble around. There we go. There we go. It just needed some persuasion. Perfect. See if I can get a bubble to form over there. That one just took off. Perfect. There, that's much better. I'm going to go to this corner. Do it again. Heat up the area till it gels up and then push the blade in. This is also very hot. Pop the tube out of the bucket out of its clamp here. There we go. Just put a little bit of pressure with my finger. You can already see it's starting to separate. There we go. Perfect. All right. Take that out. One last pass, turn the heat gun off. I'm just going to pick it up. It's very, very, very hot. Put it over on your rag. There we go. And that is indeed very hot. So while it's currently hot here, I'm going to grab another blade. And I'm just going to try and scrape off as much PVA as I can. Some people say use your hands to do this, but that's just a fantastic way to burn your hands. And it's just going to come right off. And I could just throw it on the ground for now. You know how it's like, you ever had that jello where a skin grows onto it? This is exactly what this stuff is like. It smells kind of chemically, but it acts exactly just like jello with a skin. Ah, this is very hot. There. And I just want to clean off as much as I can. It's okay if you don't get all of it. Don't forget, this is way too hot. I need another blade. Remember that once this is cooled down, we can then go at it with proper solvents. PVA does dissolve in water, kind of. Or soften up at least. But acetone is absolutely fantastic for removing PVA. And if you don't have a bottle of acetone in your house, nail polish remover works just as well. Or you can use carburetor cleaner if you by chance have a bottle of that hiding around. Also, when you're using new blades like this, you run less of a risk of nicking the glass. That won't cause it to implode, but it's a flaw that you really don't want afterwards. There. All right. Now that's pretty darn clean as it stands right now. It's still kind of filthy, but I'm going to let it cool off, and then we'll go clean it, and we'll clean the safety glass, and I'll then start working on remounting the safety glass back onto it. Now for the cleaning process, I strongly recommend, because we're working with very strong solvents, with very low flash points and very nauseous fumes, we don't do this inside. I'm actually doing it outside here, and I'm using the flipped over safety glass as basically a little dish which I can just put my acetone in as I rub away at the top of the tube. And there is a lot of rubbing and scrubbing that's going to be involved here. Don't use abrasive materials. A rag and a newspaper is all you need. And eventually you will be left with a nice and clean surface. Afterwards, once you're done with your solvents, you can then use Windex to clean off any residual matter or give it a rinse. And then once it's all nice and perfectly clean, and you verified there is absolutely no acetone left anywhere on either the safety glass or the tube, we're ready for the final step, which is remounting the safety glass to the CRT. Now, I'm sure a few of you have already asked by now why exactly we're even reinstalling the safety glass in the first place. I mean, the tube surface itself is fantastically clean, so is it really going to matter? Well, yes, it does matter. One, first, it's safety glass, so in the event the tube here fails, this is going to try and at least save your face in case it blows apart. The second thing is that these mounting points on either end of the tube, they also include with that spacing they have the thickness of the safety glass plus the thickness of the PVA material which we've already removed. So we have to reinstall it in some cases, otherwise the tube won't even properly fit inside of the monitor. Now, for the final process here, this is where our clear packing tape comes in handy, along with our foam pads, and we still have our blades. Also, just because we need to keep everything very clean now, I also now have a can of compressed air. And we'll be using this from time to time just to make sure everything's clean, as well as a clean rag to keep the surface of the tube and the backside of the safety glass clean. Remember, once this is mounted in, you really can't go back. Especially so forth if you're one of those people who don't use foam pads, but instead follow the opinion that using silicone around the edge here is the better way to do it. Well, I don't like that. One, because in case you do ever have to remove the safety glass, it's going to be a complete pain. And two, if you make some sort of mistake while mounting the safety glass, you're going to have a huge mess on your hands. Anyways, so what I want to do here is I'm going to take our foam pads, and I want to make about, oh, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I want to make 8 little strips of foam padding that are about 1/3 of an inch in thickness. Or, how is that thickness? Wide. And there we have it. We now have 8 foam pads, which we are now about to mount onto our safety glass. Now, where exactly are we going to mount these? We want to have these on the very far edge of the tube here. That's the portion of the tube which you can't even see when it's mounted inside. If it's too close or too far inwards, after everything has been assembled, you will see the pads, and it's going to look very unpleasant. So, I'm going to move my tube out of the way here. I'm going to take my rag. I'm going to flip my glass over and place it downwards. And then I will very carefully peel off the back side, or whichever side you consider the back, of these 8 strips and mount them at the very edge. There we go. Now, this is our last chance for us to clean off the glass. So if you have Windex handy, carefully clean your glass. I can have my hand on the outside because that's okay to clean once I'm done with this. But on the inside, once it's down, there's no way to go back without having to pull it all up and start over again. I'm going to flip this glass over and put it off to the side. And then I will grab my tube here, centered for you. I'm going to give it one last good clean. And what I want to do is I want to center the safety glass directly over the CRT. I don't want to have it a little bit to the left or a little bit to the right. So I will just do a test drop here with the little with one side of the sticky pad still free. And that looks like it will be okay. Hey, you can see our reflection. Hello!
And I can see a bit of dirt in here, so I'm just going to grab that and clean it off. But I think I am happy with exactly where the pads are regarding overlap, and they all seem to be very good. So I will now go and take the sticky pads off of, or take the back caps off of the foam pads. One, two, three. Remember, I don't want to touch the surface. Four, five, six, seven, eight. I'm going to give it one last blast. And I have a, there we go. I see a little bit of dirt that's stubborn right there. I don't want to touch it with my fingers. I don't want fingerprints on the inside. Now, I will very carefully place it back over on to the tube. She's down. That looks good. I'm just going to go over it with the rag here. There. And now I can go with the compressed air. I seriously cannot stress just how much I do not want dust or dirt between the two pieces of glass. And now, finally, this is where, again, we don't use silicone. This is where we use our clear packing tape. If I can find the end of it. And what I want to do is just against the edge of the tube here, I'm going to put the tape. I'm not going to stick it down yet. Right up against the edge. And don't only let it on the surface here. I don't want to stick it down completely on the edges yet. Give it one last blow. And the reason I have it like this is that any dust that's still in there right now, it will blow out the side still, or it will stick to the tape, and it's going to stay on the tape. Now, if you had a clean room, this wouldn't matter at all. But not a lot of people have clean rooms in their houses. There. And now that it's pressed there, I want to just fold it down over the edge. And secure it to the face of the tube. And try and get a little bit around the corners here. Go, and I have a little bit of a gap here, so I'm just going to grab a little bit more tape. And right around the corner, it'll go. And we just got to give it a little bit of a buff. And there we have it. Our tube is clean and 100% cataract free.
So there we have it. We now have a completely cataract free CRT that's ready to go back into our monitor. And well, that's something you're gonna have to do on your own, because this is my particular model monitor. You're going to have your own particular model monitor, or even television, and it's going to vary a fair bit. There's only one thing I got to advise you about. And that's with this little buddy right here, which you removed off the neck of the tube when you were dismantling it. This here, and this monochrome monitor here, is your deflection yoke. And when you reinstall that, you want to have that right up against the face of the tube here, as far as it'll go. And so you secure it, reassemble the rest of it, you're going to power up your monitor, and it's going to be crooked, or something's going to be a bit iffy. All you have to do is loosen that screw again, and then just twist the deflection yoke back and forth, and go in and out until you find that perfect spot where you're completely okay with the image displayed on the screen. Now for you colored people there, you have a couple more things to deal with regarding purity magnets, convergence, and even degaussing. But that's something there I'm not even going to touch myself. So honestly, play with that. There's enough calibration sets out there. You're able to do it on your own. You can degauss it. But that's all there is to it, ladies and gentlemen. And now, I got to finish completing this one. Now, at this point in the video, I'd love to give a shout out to fellow YouTuber DRH4683. Who is responsible for the first YouTube video I could find back in 2008 on treating cataracts on CRTs. Now, his was a bit of a weird video there. It's a fairly big tube, and he was recording a recording on his TV, of him working on a TV. So I thought with this video here, I could improve that a little bit by making it a little bit more high quality, and for those fellow computer enthusiasts here who are starting to run into cataracts on their own displays and screens, make it look a little less daunting for them when they had to do it themselves. Because really, as you saw, it's not all that hard. And I really do hope that this was a very entertaining and educational video, and thank you for watching.